Thank you for plugging into this Family Life News podcast, streaming issues-driven, family-focused news.
Welcome back to another edition of Capital Connection. Fridays during the Noon Report, we give you direct connection to what's happening in Albany and Harrisburg with the experts on the issues. At the state capitals, they are, as always, Jason McGuire with New Yorkers for Constitutional Freedoms and Michael Geer at the Pennsylvania Family Institute. Well, guys, after a long summer break, we are back in business, and it's been said a time or two that politics doesn't matter until after Labor Day. Well, here we are after Labor Day, so let's have at it. Jason, we'll begin with you, the race for governor. What does Lee Zeldin have to do, in your opinion, to make this a competitive contest with a little over 8 weeks to go?
Well, the most recent polling shows that Mr. Zeldin is about 4 points behind Governor Kathy Hochul. So what he needs to do is keep doing what he's doing and crisscrossing the state, shaking as many hands as he can, and doing everything he can to appeal to independent voters while not demoralizing his normally socially conservative base. He can't run from who he is, but he's got to reach an arm out to those that will be looking at those pocketbook issues in this coming election.
All right, let's head to Pennsylvania now. President Biden, Michael, has been there three times in the last 4 days, coining a new phrase along the way, Trumpies, the MAGA Republicans, as he puts it. He is bent on making this midterm very much about Donald Trump. What do you think? Will this be a referendum on Trump or President Biden?
Well, President Biden is trying to make it a referendum about Trump, and that's because they don't have any leg to stand on related to those pocketbook issues that Jason just referenced. I mean, when we look at gas prices, grocery prices, rent costs, so many different things that are impacting families, they don't have anything that they can talk about positively, and that's why they're then trying to make this a referendum about the man who occupied the White House in the previous 4 years.
Jason, political pundits are predicting that abortion rights will drive Democrats to the polls as much as inflation issues will drive Republicans to the polls. Your thoughts on that?
I think that's somewhat a narrative being spun by the Democrats right now. No doubt there's being some impact, but at the end of the day, I think people are looking at things like the prediction this week that utilities will be going up 29% or more. Gas will be on the increase again as we now see the post-Labor Day figures going up. And much of what Michael has just referenced, that's going to be driving those independent voters who are not driven by social issues to be voting for other than the incumbents in these cases.
Yeah. The Pittsburgh Post-Gazette, Michael, had an interesting op-ed this week saying that John, and this is John Fetterman's hometown newspaper, saying that his health after that stroke he suffered in May is fair game. It is a campaign issue. So far, he's not agreed to any debates. He says that will happen. We'll see. But how much of a factor is the health of John Fetterman going to be in what many are saying is the most closely watched Senate contest in the country?
Yeah, there's tons of money going into this contest, but I'm glad that the Post-Gazette took on this issue because much of the media is kind of ignoring it. John Fetterman, who suffered a stroke, didn't really reveal to the public just how devastating and troubling that stroke was to him and to his health. And if you see any of his public appearances, which are very few and far between, he only speaks for a very, very short time and speaks haltingly and mixes up his words and those sorts of things. So it absolutely should be something the voters look at in this November contest for the U.S. Senate.
All right, let's talk about the culture wars for just a minute, Jason. There's a really good article on your website. We'll give the address for that at the end. The Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer promising to bring the so-called Respect for Marriage Act up for a vote before the midterms. It may happen this month. It's already passed the House. You are very concerned about this. Why is this legislation so dangerous?
Well, on multiple levels, there's concerns with what we call the Disrespect for Marriage Act. First and foremost, a marriage is between a man and a woman. We shouldn't walk away from that position. But second, there are some tremendous religious liberty concerns that are raised if this passes, if this becomes statute, that really becomes a problem. And the third, politically speaking, for Republican candidates that look to that socially conservative base, there is little they can do to discourage those voters more than what they're doing by not talking about the issue of abortion been affirmatively voting for things like so-called gay marriage. It's a problem, really, at the polls, and it's also a problem on morality for many voters in this state and elsewhere across the country.
Yeah, and Mike, I didn't know this, but your state is the first in any state to hold a March for Life since the overthrow of Roe by the U.S. Supreme Court back in June. That will happen Monday, September 19th. What do you hope this event will accomplish in Pennsylvania, and what does it mean to be pro-life post-Roe?
Well, we hope it accomplishes a lot of things. Number one, to boost the morale of the pro-life movement, which has suffered some challenges because of the misinformation that's come out after the overturn of Roe versus Wade. Pro-abortion forces with a megaphone from the media has been suggesting that the women are not going to be able to get the kind of medical care that they need post-Roe. That's absurd and ridiculous. And we have a legislative agenda that we want to advance here in Pennsylvania in terms of protecting life. We are not going to take our foot off the pedal in terms of advancing the pro-life agenda, even as the headwinds may be challenging in this fall season, again, because of that megaphone that the media and the pro-abortion forces have.
Again, we'll give your website how folks can get ready for that coming up at the end. But Jason, I read a stat last week, blew my mind. For the first time ever, more people are smoking marijuana than cigarettes. Marijuana is about to take off big time in New York State in the coming months. What's your biggest concern about that?
Well, my concern is the young people that really are now seeing this as something legitimate to engage in. It is dangerous, particularly for that developing mind. And yet more and more, we are seeing that when you legalize something, you send the message that there's nothing wrong with it to go ahead and participate in that particular activity. It's a problem. It's only going to grow in the years to come.
And along those lines, Michael, Governor Wolf has already begun the process of pardoning thousands of low-level marijuana drug convictions this month. Both he and John Fetterman insist this is a harmless drug. Is marijuana harmless?
It is absolutely not a harmless drug, and this is part and parcel of the Wolf administration to try to advance their agenda by executive fiat, or in this case doing pardons, which he's allowed to do, but he is going around the legislature to try to force ultimately his agenda, which is legalizing recreational marijuana.
We'd be remiss, Jason, if we didn't bring up the new gun restrictions in New York. This is a big story, and it's leaving a lot of people confused as far as when do I have a right to carry, where can I carry. Are any of those questions being answered?
Well, you know, it's interesting. We heard that the Civil War reenactment is actually being canceled as a result of this. I mean, you can't even have Civil War reenactors now carrying those weapons that are simply shooting blanks, muzzle loaders on various properties. This really is just so beyond, you know, where the Second Amendment is. This is a slap in the face to gun owners. And I'll tell you, I'm concerned about what it means for church security teams in particular. In recent years, most churches have established some level of a church security team. But now, under this new legislation, you know, pushed by and promoted by Governor Kathy Hochul, churches cannot have security teams unless they are hired professionals or active or retired law enforcement. Most churches cannot afford that, and it makes them sitting ducks in those various churches across the state.
Hmm. Well, we started with politics. We'll end with it. An interesting article this week that kind of flew under the radar, despite receiving the endorsements and the support of the powerful teachers' unions in Pennsylvania, Michael. Both Josh Shapiro and John Fetterman send their children to private schools, and these are pretty expensive private schools, north of $35,000 a year to attend these schools. Isn't that hypocritical, given their stance on things like school vouchers, for instance?
Yeah, it absolutely is. I think my reaction to that story was, so what else is new? I mean, this is a part and parcel of what we've seen throughout opposition to school choice by many politicians. Bill Clinton, famously opposing school choice, sent his daughter Chelsea to a swanky a private school in the Washington, D.C. area. That's pretty standard, and what it boils down to is it's good for me, but not for you. Those folks that are vociferously against giving parents the option to send their children to the school of their choice are often those who have the financial wherewithal and send their kids to the school of their choice while denying it to Pennsylvanians or to Americans.
All right. Just like that, our 10 minutes are up, but there's so much more information on the issues on your websites. Jason, if folks want to learn more about what you're calling the Disrespect for Marriage Act, you have a very well-written article on your website. Where can they find that?
That's at albanyupdate.com.
And the Pennsylvania March for Life is fast approaching Monday, September 19th. Michael, where can folks go and sign up for that?
PAFamily.org.